This is Ethan Wills, Executive Director of the Midland-Odessa Symphony and Chorale. We are so excited to be breaking ground on this new podcast series where we feature our local musicians in the symphony, as well as some of our guests on the season. For our first inaugural podcast, we are collaborating with the West Texas Jazz Society to interview the guest on our March 6 Pops concert, Tony DeSere. He sat down with Eric Baker, co-principal trumpet of the symphony and president of the West Texas Jazz Society. For information on Tony, visit www.tonydesere.com. Please also follow the West Texas Jazz Society and Midland-Odessa Symphony and Chorale online to plug in to the arts in West Texas.
Thank you so much for sitting down and talking to us.
Absolutely.
I think we should get started by asking, how did you get started in music?
Well, you know, I was always fascinated with music, and my dad plays guitar and sings still to this day, and he would work his 9-to-5 job at a plumbing and heating store and come home and play guitar. And he would play guitar for hours, you know, after dinner, and that was my earliest exposure, you know, as a child, just kind of hearing James Taylor and the Eagles and the Beatles and Kenny Rogers songs, and he would learn them and play them. And so I grew up with live music in the house just because my dad loved to play. So the first instrument that I could play in school was the violin. That was the first one that was offered. And I love music, so I came home and said, you know, I'd like to play the violin. And my mom said, okay. So I got a violin. I started lessons. But I was always most fascinated with the piano, just something about seeing someone play the piano and seeing the keys and everything just fascinated me about it. And we didn't have one in the house. We didn't even have anything, you know. So around the time I was 10 years old, I just started to really, anytime we went to the mall, you know, in the Radio Shack in the mall, there was those Casio keyboards.
Nice.
Remember those displays?
Oh, yeah, with the built-in beats and everything.
Oh, yeah, the boom, chikum, goom, chikum, goom, chikum, chikum, you know, all that. So I would go and I'd play on those as long as I could in the mall until I annoyed the people working in Radio Shack. And then my parents decided to get me a little Casio, probably 56-key keyboard. And I was obsessed with it. And then my dad and I started to jam together. I got official kind of small town teacher piano lessons. And that's when I really started to focus on that. So that was, I just fell in love with ragtime. I loved Scott Joplin's The Entertainer, and that was my mission. I started piano. I didn't want to do any of the scales. I didn't want any of that. I was like, I was only interested in playing The Entertainer.
Yep.
So the first year I worked tirelessly. Even if it took me a week to get the first two measures, you know, that's what I did. And for my first piano recital, I played The Entertainer, the whole thing.
That's great.
And the second year, I discovered Rhapsody in Blue. And Rhapsody in Blue is what taught me how to play the piano.
Yeah.
Because I spent that next whole year learning it to the best of my ability. And now it's, you know, in recent years, brushed it up again and actually perform it with orchestras. It's really, you know, been a dream come true. But anyway, that's kind of how I got into it. And then I wasn't going to necessarily do it for a job. I was, you know, I was planning on going to school pre-med. But this was all like, you know, the singing came later. It came, you know, when I was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was shy. I mean, I never played for anybody. But then when I started to, it had a real effect, you know, on people that I saw, and it was fun.
Yeah.
So by the time I had already applied and gotten into college, I, you know, was starting to become a professional musician. I was starting to play gigs locally. And so when I started school, it just kind of one thing led to another. And I ended up getting a following on campus and decided halfway through I wasn't going to pursue the medical aspect of it, and decided I'd get a business degree and then move to New York City and try my hand at a music career. So,
wow. Very good. Well, we have a mutual friend in Bucky Pizzarelli.
Oh, yes.
And Bucky has been a long time attendee of our West Texas Jazz Party that we have out here.
I came out with him one year.
I was going to say, yeah, that's been a few years.
It's been a long time, but yeah.
And you probably would have dealt with our former president, Margaret Gillum, who was longtime amazing president of the Jazz Society and brought her out. So, man, what was it like, you know, playing with him, touring with him, doing gigs with him?
Well, it was great. I mean, in a lot of ways, I owe him a lot of my success that I was able to, you know, in transitioning from somebody who plays in a hotel lounge or piano bar to someone who, plays at a jazz club and tours. You know, that's because at that point in my career, this was like 2002, 2003, I was playing a lot in New York City, befriended Joe Piscopo, the comedian from Saturday Night Live, and he came in, he saw me at this piano bar, and he started to hire me to play piano and be his music director for shows, because he just loved the way I play. I could play One for My Baby, like just like Bill Miller does for Frank Sinatra, and he loved that. So Joe got asked to host the Jazz Emergency Jazz Fund, you know, of New York City. They have for jazz musicians that are unable to pay medical bills or housing expenses. They have a big fundraiser, and they asked Joe to kick off the second half and have him sing, because he sings, you know, various things, Frank Sinatra, whatever he does, part of his comedy. So they put a band together for him, and they assigned Bucky to our band because it was kind of the vibe, you know, Bucky's kind of Freddie Green style quarter notes on the guitar. So we met at Joe's house. First time I met Bucky was at Joe Piscopo's house, and we had a little rehearsal, and Bucky just liked me. You know, he liked the way I sang. I mean, I have a very kind of old school sensibility. Mm-hmm. And we did the gig at the Apollo Theater, and I went to go see him at a New Jersey jazz club called Shanghai Jazz. And he's like, come on, sit in. So I got up and I sat in for one song, and then people wanted me to, so he had me stay for the whole set. You know, so I pretty much took over Bucky's set at a Shanghai Jazz show, which then got me a gig offer at that club. And then around the same time, I'd met a producer at the Friars Club, you know, famous Friars Club in New York City. You know, remember the, you know, people that are a little older remember the roasts, you know, the Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra roast. But the Friars Club in New York City is the entertainment fraternity.
Yep.
And I met this guy, Billy Terrell, who would eventually become my producer, but I would hang out at the Friars Club, and he would say, I want to record you, and, you know, you could be, you know, we could do so much. But, you know, I kept pushing him and kept asking him, but it didn't seem to be happening. But when I met Bucky, he was more interested, because then it's like, oh, this is some other element. So I asked Bucky if he would record with me. And Bucky's like, yeah, just make it close to my house. You know, that's all he said. So I researched recording studios nearby Saddle River, New Jersey, where Bucky lives, and found one in, I guess, was it Patterson? And Bucky came. I mean, I didn't know how long he was going to stay to record. I'd be happy to get him on one or two tunes. He stayed an entire session day. We recorded half an album in a day. Then he's like, when are we going to finish it? So went back the next day, and we made a whole album, which became my first album that was released on Telluck Records in 2005.
Amazing. That's amazing.
So, so Bucky was a catalyst for making all that happen. And also just a vote of confidence, you know, because he, you know, the great thing about Bucky was that you didn't have to guess kind of how he was feeling about something. You know, he was very just who he was, very authentic, not man of many words, but, you know, I know that if he didn't want to do it, he wouldn't, you know. And just like, you know, he didn't have to say a lot. We just do a take, and he was like, that's a hit record. You know, that's all he'd say. Like, you sing like it's the easiest thing in the world, you know, like stuff like that. And it just really made a difference. And I had the opportunity to work with Bucky throughout the years, and was fortunate enough to see him just a couple months before he passed away. I was in New York City last February. Mm. And I did actually kind of was overseeing a recording with John Pizzarelli and my guitarist, who are friends, and they were doing some seventh string guitar duets. And on that trip, I went to visit Bucky, and, you know, at that point he was, you know, definitely not aware so much of what was going on. But when I started singing, he recognized that I was there, and that was really an unforgettable moment for me.
So, I'm sure.
Yeah.
No, he was just such a wonderful person, always just like you said, that infectious energy, so eager to promote and celebrate young artists that we've had. For the West Texas Jazz Party, in the years where we could have it, we would bring in some young people to come do a little scholarship audition. And we actually named that after him. So we do offer out the
great
Bucky Pizzarelli Jazz Scholarship each year to a young high school musician that wants to study jazz in college.
Yeah.
And so that's our very small but meaningful tribute, you know, to him.
That's great.
So what has this last year looked like for you?
Well, first it was terrifying.
Yeah.
I was on the road, starting a Midwest tour. It was going to be like 25 dates in 30 days. And, you know, I left for the tour with things starting to shut down. But the managers of the tour were like, no, we're still doing it. I'm like, are you sure?
Yeah.
So we get all the way out there. We drive, you know, we fly into Minneapolis, get the van, get all the equipment, load it all up, drive untold hours to Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I do one show, and the whole tour gets canceled. And,
oh, my goodness.
And they find us flights home, and that's it. And then I'm home. And at that point, it was like, well, now what do I do? I'd been on the road almost constantly for 15 years. And it was like, well, I don't have now. Nothing is certain. I mean, that was such a weird time, right, with people rushing to the grocery store and,
yeah,
you know,
buying up all the toilet paper.
All the toilet paper. So, and all that, you know, and the thing that's been challenging, I think, for a lot of people, especially in my shoes, whereas, you know, I've always been a freelancer and, you know, you kind of plan on, you know, if there's a patch of time where you don't have a lot of work, you really tighten things up and don't spend a lot. But what really swept the rug out from people's feet is that, you know, we had gigs booked. I had tons of work booked. So did a lot of other people, and all of a sudden it was all gone. So it was like, well, all that income that I was counting on is no longer there. So, but it's like, what are you going to do? But thankfully, I wasn't in a place where that became my biggest concern. I mean, it certainly was. And then the first day I was home, and I just kind of lounged around and worried. Then the next day I got up and I felt like I just wanted to do something and create something. So I got ready like I was going to work. I put on a black, back then I put on just t-shirt and jeans. And I recorded a song in my home studio. Wrap Your Troubles in Dreams, because it would make me feel better. And I thought, you know, for my Facebook following and all that, they would, you know, maybe it would make them feel better. And it did. And I just kept getting up and recording a song every day. And I did 100 days in a row.
Wow.
Without a break.
Wow.
From March until whenever that was, 100 yeah. days. And I'm still doing it. I just put out number 213, I guess. And I'm going to put one out today that I recorded a few days ago.
Oh, fantastic. But,
so I put out over 200 performances of me singing since and playing piano since then.
Mm-hmm.
And have really, you know, it's been great because it's like I finally got good at recording myself and good at singing for recording, which is, you know, is different than singing live. And it's something that I always knew why the greats of the past, like Frank Sinatra and Rosemary Clooney, why they were so good is because they were always recording and having to do it in one take.
Yeah.
Like when you can record and know that you can fix it, then you don't have to sing everything perfectly. And you're like, you know, while you're doing it, it's like, oh, that was flat. I'll just fix it after. So now I'm in a situation where I can't, you know, I have the piano playing in the room with this big tube mic and it picks up the piano. So I can't pitch correct my voice and I just got to sing it right. And I got to play it. And I don't like mix takes together. I don't comp takes together.
Mm-hmm.
So I just keep doing it till I like it. And then I put it out. And that's been immensely helpful in keeping my skills sharp and also making me way better than I was before. I mean, before I couldn't listen to myself. I had a hard time. Now it's like, I don't mind. I can listen to myself. It's been a wonderful connection with this new online following that I have of wonderful, kind people.
Mm-hmm.
That support me every single day, write on for over 200 videos, write a comment on my wall thanking me.
Yeah.
I started doing live stream concerts for my basement. I upgraded my setup only slightly. I had everything almost I needed. I just needed a thing to be able to switch cameras live and get it into the PC.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started doing those, and those paid just as well at the end as a gig on the road.
Yep.
You know, I can do them every week, but I did one every few months, and people showed up and supported me and sent me in between, sent me PayPal donations, sent me checks, you know, just little things that just got me through.
Yeah.
And I got back on the road in August of 20. And I've kind of been doing, first I just kind of did one thing a month. And now this week actually kicks off a very busy period for me through May. I mean, I'm very busy through May, which I can't believe it.
Are you doing a symphony orchestra for this whole tour, or are you doing some different?
Some different things. I just was with the Seattle Symphony two nights ago. And I do the Naples Philharmonic in Florida next week.
Oh, that's great.
And then I go to New York City to shoot something for the Carlisle Hotel and play a couple songs. And a great nonprofit called Jazz at the Ballroom. If people don't know about that, check that out. This lady that I met a few years ago at the Carlisle, actually, I kind of talked her into starting her own. She's taking the bull by the horns. I was like, you could be the new Norman Granz. You know, you could be the, you know, person that really keeps jazz and recordings going, you know, in a time when record companies aren't in, you know, I mean, and now what are even record companies anyway? So,
yeah.
So anyway, I'm doing that. Then I'm doing the National Symphony at the Kennedy Center in April, doing the Dallas Symphony.
Great. And, yeah, that's my hometown.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Okay. So it's busy. And, you know, I actually got used to staying home though. So it's like, it's a little weird.
Yeah.
To, you know, it's been a little stressful facing, you know, all that I have to do. But then, you know, I'm really also so fortunate and so lucky to do it that I'm trying not to let it stress me out too much.
Absolutely. All right. Well, we are at the end of our time, but I do want to do a quick lightning round here.
Sure.
So I've got some awesome, these are called pod decks. These are little interview questions. So
okay.
30 seconds, maybe 10 seconds each.
Okay.
Which living person do you most admire?
My mom.
All right. Which band or artist, dead or alive, would play at your funeral?
I guess if it was Frank Sinatra, I guess.
I was going to say,
yeah.
I think I would do that. All right. Here's a good one. If you could ask one person one question and they had to answer truthfully, who and what would you ask?
Wow, that's an interesting question. Well, it would probably be somebody about if there's really aliens or not.
We're going to go to the Pentagon here and ask them.
Somebody knows.
What do you consider your greatest achievement?
My greatest achievement? Well, I think other than my son, who's a miracle of life, to, you know, that he exists. My greatest achievement, just I think in my own sphere of life, is just pulling this off, this career off, as well as I have for all these years, against the odds, kind of, and just kind of at first blindly going into it, but now realizing it's like, how did I ever stick with it and still be able to do this, and it's at the level that I am. I mean, it's really you know, I get to do like the best possible gig without being famous. You know what I mean? It's like performing with great orchestras and the same concert halls that Frank Sinatra performed in or Tony Bennett played in, but yet I can go out to dinner after and, you know, only people that have been to the show know who I am.
Right. Well, we're very glad that you're still doing that and very glad your career has been going on. We wish you all the best. Last one. Which talent would you most like to have?
What I most like to have, I'd like to be able to draw, because I'm a person that loves to develop different talents, mm-hmm. and it keeps me interested and keeps me, you know, it's fun to get into things. So over the years, while I was learning how to play piano, I was getting into audio engineering and MIDI and all that, and then the last 10 years, I got heavily in the video and lenses, and, you know, I immerse myself in these things and become, you know, semi-pro at them enough to be solid at it. So, but no matter what, I can't seem to get graphic or art stuff worth a damn.
Yeah. Can't draw. Well, I can't either. So I don't know. It must be a musician thing. Tony, thank you so much for sitting
You're
down
welcome.
And doing
thank
this.
You.
We want everybody to go check him out. It's tonydesare.com.
That's right.
And that's DESARE.com. And you can find him on Facebook and check out some of those amazing videos.
Yeah, Facebook is my Facebook music page is where most of my audience is. But I also put the videos out on YouTube and Instagram.
All right, everybody. Go check him out. Thanks again.
Thank you.
As a child, I went wild when the band played. As I ran to the man while his hand swayed. Clarinets were my pets, and the slide trombone I thought was simply divine. But today, when they play, I could hiss them. Every bar is a jar to my system. But there's one musical instrument that I call mine. I love a piano, I love a piano. I love to hear somebody play upon a piano, a grand piano. It simply carries me away. I know a fine way to treat a Steinway. I love to run my fingers o'er the keys, the ivories, and with the pedal I love to meddle. When Paderewski comes this way, I'd be delighted to be invited to hear that long-haired genius play. So you can keep your fiddle and your bow. I love the P-I-A-N-O-O-O. I wanna stop right beside an upright or a high-toned baby grand. Thank you. whiskey comes this way. I'd be delighted to be invited to hear that long-haired genius play. So you can keep your fiddle and your bow. I love the P-I-A-N-O-O. I want to stop right beside an upright or a high tone.
Thank you.